So in this session we will discuss about power electronics devices, mainly thyristors, their working and design principles. This presentation is basically prepared for undergraduate students doing BTech in electrical and electronics engineering by Professor Agam Kumar Tyagi. Thyristor is a semiconductor device which is used as a power switch in power electronics. It is basically a four layer device having three junctions J1, J2, J3. In transistors we are having three layers PNP or NPN. In thyristor we are having four layers PNPN and three terminals anode, cathode and gate. Broadly thyristors are of four types. Number 1 silicon controlled rectifier SCR. Number 2 TRIAC, which is a bidirectional switch. DIAC, this is also a bidirectional switch. And GTU, that is gate turn off thyristor. Silicon controlled rectifier SCR is normally also called as thyristor. As can be seen in its block diagram, it is having three terminals anode, cathode and gate. And three junctions are there J1, J2 and J3. The gate terminal is not exactly between P and N junctions, that is J2. It is somewhat near to P junction as can be seen in the figure. So these are the VI characteristics of thyristors. Four regions are there: forward blocking, forward conduction, reverse blocking, which can be seen by reverse leakage current, and reverse conduction, which is after reverse breakdown voltage. Latching current and holding currents are also there. Holding current is the minimum current required to turn off the conducting thyristor, and latching current is the minimum current required to turn on a thyristor. So obviously IL is greater than IH. So these are the transient characteristics of a thyristor. TQ is the device of time and TC is the circuit of time. After applying a reverse voltage VAK, it takes at least TC time. You can say time TC is required to turn it off physically. Now again IH and IL. As mentioned before, IH is the holding current and IL is the latching current of the thyristor. This is the broad definition of holding and latching current. Now SCR turn on methods. There are basically five methods to turn on a SCR. High voltage turn on, or you can say forward breakdown. It occurs when the forward voltage exceeds the breakdown voltage of junction J2. Gate triggering, we applied a gate pulse to turn on the thyristor when it is forward biased. D/dt, when the rate of change of voltage is very high, that is typically greater than 200 microvolt per microsecond, the thyristor turns on automatically without applying a gate pulse. This is called as D/dt rating. The D/dt rating of a typical thyristor is 200 volt per microsecond, or you can say 200 into 10 to the power minus 6 volt per second. Light triggering, we apply a laser pulse at the gate junction and the thyristor turns on. Temperature or thermal triggering, we heat the junction J2 until it's breakdown and the thyristor starts conducting. Broadly, you can see the definition of working of high voltage triggering, or you can say forward breakdown triggering. Triggering means turn on the thyristor, then gate triggering. Then D/dt triggering. Then light triggering. देन टेम्परेचर डिग्री, then SCR gate triggering techniques. Normally we use gate triggering because it is more economical, convenient and easy to design, and we get more accuracy in this technique. So conventionally we are using three methods: resistance triggering or R triggering. In this we use a resistive circuits to provide the gate pulse. RC triggering, we use resistance and capacitances. And unijunction transistor triggering is also used, in which we use a UJT characteristics in order to get a gate pulse or a firing pulse for the SCR. Commutation means to turn off the SCR. The SCR commutes or turned off only when its anode current is less than the holding current. This is the two transistor model of a thyristor. The important thing to note down is you cannot make a thyristor by combining two transistors, but in order to understand the characteristics or working of a thyristor, it can be represented by two transistor. One is PNP and second is NPN, as can be seen in the figure. Uppermost is the anode terminal, lowermost is the cathode, and the common base of the two transistors. The base of the lower one and the collector of the upper one is the gate terminal. Thyristor production. Normally we require di by dt and d by dt production. As mentioned earlier, if the d by dt of the supply is quite high, the thyristor will turn on without applying any gate pulse. So this is called as false triggering. In order to avoid this, we have to provide d by dt protection. Di by dt protection is required because of rate of change of current is very high. There are chances that thyristor may burn out due to local hot spots which are formed when current is spreading at a very low rate, whereas the rate of change of actual current is very high. So in order to provide these two types of protection, di by dt, we connect a inductor in series with the thyristor, which limits the rate of change of current which is flowing in the thyristor. And d by dt, we apply a RC circuit or a snubber circuit in parallel with the SCR in order to limit the rate of change of applied voltage. This is a typical protection circuit of a SCR. LS is the inductance which is connected in series to limit the SCR current, and RS and CS are the snubber resistance and capacitances which are used to limit the rate of change of supply voltage across a SCR. RL is the load connected to the SCR. So when switch S1 is turned on, the current will rise suddenly and so is the rate of change of voltage. So LS will prevent the rate of change of current which is flowing, and the parallel circuit R and C across the SCR will limit the rate of change of voltage. As current cannot change instantaneously across an inductor, so we are using an inductor in series, and similarly voltage magnitude cannot change suddenly across a capacitance, so we are using RC in the parallel. Series operation is required when the supply voltage is very high for a single SCR to sustain. We connect two SCR in parallel, so that we can apply higher supply voltage. The condition is both the SCR should have a similar VI characteristics so that they can be operated in series. Parallel operation is required when the load current is more than the rated current of a single thyristor SCR. It also requires that the VI characteristics of the both the SCRs which are connected in parallel should be similar. Otherwise, what will happen? More current will flow through a single SCR and less will flow through the other SCR. Therefore, this is a requirement, mandatory requirement, that their IV characteristics should be same. Now, these are the four disadvantages of JTU. The advantage of JTU is basically that it can be turned off by applying a gate pulse. A normal thyristor SCR cannot be turned off by applying a gate pulse. It can be turned on, but in order to turn it off, we have to make the anode current less than the holding current. Whereas in case of JTU, we can turn it on by simply applying a negative gate pulse. But it is having the following four disadvantages due to which they are not normally used in power electronic circuits. This is a symbol of JTU and its VI characteristics. These are the advantages of JTU. DIAC is basically used to make the firing circuit of a triac. DIAC symbolically can be understood as two diodes connected in anti-parallel. So this is basically a bidirectional switch. This is the block diagram, symbol and VI characteristics of a DIAC. In forward as well as reverse direction, as you can see, it is turned on after 0.7 volt or you can say 1 volt typically. Triac is also a thyristor family device. It can be considered as two SCR connected in anti-parallel and their gate is combined. So it can flow the current in both the directions, whereas SCR can conduct only in one direction, that is from anode to cathode. This is the symbol and block diagram of a triac. This is the VI characteristics of a triac. Its characteristics in first quadrant and third quadrant remains the same. Now, control characteristics of various devices which are used in power electronics. The only difference is transistor requires a continuous pulse, MOSFET also required a continuous pulse, whereas SCR only requires a triggering pulse, and once it is on, the pulse can be removed. And same is the case with TRIAC and GTU. As can be seen here, at time 0 we are only applying a pulse and it is turned on, and after that it does not require any pulse. Whether you apply a negative pulse also, it is not turned off. It is currently supplying the output voltage V0, which is equal to Vs. So these are the control characteristics of SCR. Now, as can be seen from this one, GTU control characteristics, it is turned on by applying a positive gate pulse, and when we apply a negative gate pulse, it is turned off. Transistor is very common. When you apply a gate pulse at the base signal VB, it is on. Until there is a gate signal, it remains on, and when you remove the signal from the base of the transistor, it is turned off. In this case, we are using transistor as a switch. That is saturation and cutoff region. In saturation region, transistor is on, whereas in cutoff region, it is off. Same is the case with MOSFET. Till you are applying VGS, it is on, and when VGS signal is removed, it is off. And same characteristics hold good for IGBT. Transistor is a current control device, whereas MOSFET and IGBT are voltage control devices. Now these are the classification of various power electronics devices based upon their characteristics, in the direction in which they can conduct, unidirectional or bidirectional, whether they are controlled or uncontrolled, whether they are controlled on or uncontrolled off. These are the 9 types of things which you should understand properly, because this will help you in selection of a proper power electronics switch when you are designing a power electronic system like rectifier, MOSFET, chopper, whatever. These are the basics and should always be kept into mind. Now this is how you can make a thyristorized controller. A power source will always be there. Then thyristorized power controllers, which are supplying power to the load equipment. Then a control circuit is required along with the measuring unit, so that you can control the thyristorized power controller in order to control the output voltage, current or power which is supplied to the load equipment. Now these are some of the applications of thyristorized power controller. Nowadays these are prominently used in various control equipments, industries, robotics, AC and DC power transmission and distribution. These are the advantages of thyristorized power controllers. The disadvantage remains that these produce some harmonics into the system, as all these devices and controllers are highly nonlinear devices. Now these are the disadvantages of thyristorized power controllers. Types of power electronic converters, which mostly are covered in a basic course of power electronics for undergraduate students, and at design level and fabrication level in a M.Tech course of power electronics and drives. Basically they are AC to DC converters, rectifiers, DC to DC converters, choppers, DC to AC converters, inverters, and AC to AC converters, normally called as cycloconverters. This is a rectifier circuit or AC to DC converter, which is made by using a diode and a center tap transformer. This is basically a full wave diode rectifier. This is again a full wave rectifier, but it is measured by using a thyristor. So you can see the difference, output alpha, firing angle alpha. You can control the V average and VRMS voltage which you are supplying to the load, and so you can also control the power which is being supplied to the load. These are AC voltage regulators, or you can say fan regulators, in which you control the magnitude of the AC voltage, RMS magnitude of the AC voltage. In this we are using a triac. These are some issues related to SCR packaging. Electrical isolation is required, good thermal performance, good electrical performance, long life, high reliability, and obviously the cost of packaging should be low. Best wishes to you for viewing this video patiently. For further queries, you can go to my blog agamtyagiblogspot.com, or you can mail me at tyagiagam@gmail.com.